This is about myparcel.com, not to make it too complex. It's not myparcel.nl, but maybe Lars will say something about that as well during our conversation. This is again an e-commerce world where we do see many challenges ahead of us. How do you integrate your shipping? What type of platforms can you use? And how can sort of also you operate in the e-commerce domain and trying to be successful? How does that help you to expand in new markets? Those are just a couple of topics that I would like to engage you with as well during this workshop. So feel free if you have questions in between. And otherwise, we have also a couple of questions with the Slido at the end, then we can get some further engagement. So we'll have a fun place today. This is your final chance to put your votes in for the awards. The awards ceremony will be following this one in the main hall around 3 o'clock. Right? We know that we have said this a million times, but it is your opportunity to vote who you think is the cool vendor, the runner-up, and those type of things. Which of the companies do you like? You know, over the past 2 days, you saw many presentations and visions and stuff. Hey, what did really appeal to me as a retailer, e-tailer, omni-channel operator in this domain? Obviously, after that, we still have a final masterclass. So if you can stick around, hey, you got the stamina, so your business must be flourishing as well, if you do that as well today. So anyway, without further ado, I would like to introduce Lars, the CEO and founder of myparcel.com. He will lead us in the first part of the session through his adventures and the value proposition and how he sort of perceives the key trends in the market. So Lars, yes. Go ahead.
Thank you, Ernst. Just double checking the mic. It all works fine, I think. I've been able to already meet some of you prior to this conference, so I was able to shake hands, which was quite new considering the times that we've been through the past 2 years. So that was quite a great experience for me. So I took advantage of that to already meet some of you. As you know, or some of you know, my name is Lars. I'm the CEO and also the managing director of myparcel.com. I just want to welcome you here in Amsterdam, which is our hometown. I feel quite honored to have you all here. Hope you had pleasant days here in Amsterdam. Hopefully you also were able to visit the city of Amsterdam maybe yesterday evening. I think a lot of them did because we have some empty spots here. So they probably already went home or maybe still in Amsterdam. Without further ado, I just want to quickly introduce myself. I need to put the green one, right?
Yep, correct. The green one, upside the higher.
Yeah, this one. It's new for me, so let me just grab the technology. Let's see. I think I have to quickly move back. All right. Well, I think one of the slides was actually... hold on.
That's fine.
Yeah, that's, you can see I can lead a technology company, right? Which all goes great. Ah, there we go. Yeah, so I just want to quickly introduce myself, really short. This slide sort of like shows who I am as a person. It's just my family, my dad. I like to go to soccer as well, visiting Ajax Amsterdam, which I'm a big fan of. And that also relates to our business being in Amsterdam, so that's why we have a special connection with that city. If you ever need any tips for going out in Amsterdam, I'll glad to show you after the presentation. Enough about me, a bit about my business. I started with e-commerce in 2007, so 14 years of experience in e-commerce. I had several online stores together with my brother Niels. We sold several gift packages through the internet, and at the time we had to work with the tech of the courier companies. So PostNL, like bpost and those kind of companies, we had to ship all of our parcels. And it was dreadful. It was just like a frustration on a day-to-day basis. We wanted to ship a lot of parcels, but systems got stuck. CSV uploads, it was all dreadful. So we decided we needed software that would do this a lot more efficient. And it was well integrated within our warehouse management software as well. So we just were quite entrepreneurial and we said, well, why don't we create this software ourselves? So we built software just for internal use. We used it for 3 months and then we decided, well, why don't we show this to some of our colleagues in the market, which also had online stores. They were very enthusiastic. And then they used it also for several months. They were that enthusiastic that we thought we should do something with this opportunity. There's apparently a gap in the market. Why don't we just call this business My Parcel, get started and see where it goes. Turned out to be a quite a success. We grew 130% each year, year over year, up to 2015, where we had 20,000 customers using our software on a daily basis, so online stores, owning half of the Dutch market as well as the Belgian market. So we became market leaders in 2015. And then there, it also just naturally sparked an interest for all of the carriers. So we talked to DHL, but we also talked to PostNL, which wanted to buy our company, our software. We sort of like put that aside for quite a bit, so we ignored them for a while until the offer was just too good to ignore. And then we sold the business to PostNL in 2015. There was one condition though. We always had the ambition to really create shipping software for enterprise. So that was sort of like the bigger dream that we had. We've always focused on small retailers. Now we want to do the same thing for large enterprises. So what we were able to do when we sold the company, we still had the right to use the same name, My Parcel. We bought the myparcel.com domain to be able to go international. And we were able to then target a new different target group, which is enterprise businesses. That's what we did in 2015. We started and then we quickly grew. And then we got another investment round in, let me see, when was that again? I almost forgot. 2017 was the first investment round that we got. And another one followed 2 years later. Enough about our business. Let's move over to why we are here today. What I would like to discuss with you, and we would be happy to also hear your feedback regarding this topic, is key considerations when you move to new markets. So what kind of struggles are there within your current solutions? Like what things do we come across that really make it hard to go to new markets? And that's what we like to put central today in this presentation. I think there's never been a better time to go to new markets, as like all the markets have sort of like exploded over the last year. Double-digit growth in almost every market. So I believe if you really want to expand your business and grow, you could leverage from like all of the volume or all of the grown demand from a consumer perspective in your local market. But what truly will provide exponential growth is going to new markets and also profit from that growth as well. On the slide, you will see some numbers. I will not go through them one by one, but it shows double-digit growth for every market in the world. And this is just a really good time to start thinking about expansion to new markets. And what I think would be central today as well is that you consider your shipping strategy as a vital part of your rollout strategy. So don't consider these things to be two different things. And first think, well, I'm going to go to a new market. You did a lot of research of which market fits best, which culture fits the product. If it really suits your business, and then forget about shipping and then come to the conclusion that, there's no real good alternative for shipping as well. So let that be a central point in your rollout strategy. Cool. The success in all of these markets also have quite a few downsides. So what we've seen, especially with COVID really kicking in, is that a lot of the carriers are struggling at the moment. So carrier performance has drastically gone down, putting an immense pressure on customer service, I think for all retailers. You probably will have experienced that yourself as well. That's what you can see as well in this graph, which is an example of one of our customers with an example carrier that they're using. that you see that spike when COVID started, drastically going from a successful delivery percentage of like 97%, all the way decreasing till I think it was 77% at one point. So that led to like massive delays all over for all carriers, I believe. Maybe less for the slightly newer ones, which benefited from that quite a bit. But for all the main carriers like the DHLs, UPS, they all had like major issues delivering their parcels on time. Another side effect of like the increased pressure on these carriers is what we've noticed from all of our customers, that prices went up. They couldn't add any more volume to the already existing volume. So they tried to maximize all the margins from their existing business. So they've tried to then increase prices for the existing business just to make more money. And that's what we see also across all sectors as well. Of course, we also had some other changes in the playing field regarding regulatory changes. So Brexit, of course, taking place in January this year, led to a lot of, especially things to consider in terms of data exchange. All carriers requiring different kinds of information, and that all had to be managed well as well. So if you were doing all of these carrier integrations yourself, you probably experienced that it took a lot of manpower to make sure that you're Brexit-proof and Brexit-ready. That took a massive effect as well. IOSS, I think, is a very important other topic as well that we've experienced in July 2020 of this year. Also needing different kinds of data for all carriers. So there are a lot of changes in the playing field that sort of like you have to cope with and you need to take into account. What I've mentioned earlier is that, of course, I consider the shipping strategy to be a crucial part in your rollout strategy, especially because your strategy will then impact, of course, pricing. It will eventually also determine whether you are able to compete with local markets. So if you decide to ship, for instance, from your warehouses, I don't know, in the UK and ship everything via UPS cross-border, you have such high costs that you will not be able to compete with local players that are able to leverage from the local players within that market. And of course, it's important to also know what your potential consumers within that new market expect from a shipping perspective. So I think, Ernst, maybe we could focus on that a bit more to see also maybe what your customers expect in certain markets and whether you're able to then meet those demands.
I think it's always good, sort of, we touched upon in some of the workshops and the presentations on the, let's say, the local differences around culture and sort of expectations on the client. Does anybody would like to share something on to say sort of, hey, this was really, if we would have known that in advance, right, that would make our life much simpler, for instance. Or we, if you don't want to comment yet, we pick that up during the questions as well, because there's one or two questions in Slido referring to this one, and we pick it up accordingly. Is that okay?
Okay. Thanks. Next I want to discuss some possible approaches, just to sort of like show what options there are. You might be familiar with them, you might not be. But I think it would be good to also to spark some ideas as well to discuss later on with the questions at the end of the workshop. Of course, there's like the thing that most starting retailers start with, just having their own contracts and then just activating multiple origins or multiple destinations, I must say. So it's one origin, multiple destinations. It's sort of like what everybody starts with, I think, in the beginning. There's an ability to also, when you do not have as much volume for a new market, to also buy directly from a reseller. So there are plenty, I think every local market has its resellers that has slightly better rates than you would be able to get yourself when you start in a new market. Good example of these are, for instance, SendCloud or MyParcel.nl, my previous business. They have better rates than you would get yourself if you are really a starter, have no volume. But it might also apply to bigger retailers starting in new markets, not having any volume there. So it could be a good starting point to at least get started, see if the product fits, And have a slight gain on the shipping price or the purchasing of the shipping price. Of course, it's also possible to access rates via a physical consolidator. So what I just discussed are virtual consolidators, which do nothing more than just provide you with a platform and shipping rates. But you also have these physical ones, which will then accept all of your parcels in one of their warehouses and then consolidate for multiple clients and then direct inject into the carrier network. Will probably also result in slightly lower rates. There are several cross-border specialists as well that could be leveraged from. What typically they do is that they sell this as their own solution. However, they use a mix of different carriers in the background. Some examples of these are Ascendia, for instance, or Spring GDS, Landmark Global, and they often derive from local carriers within those countries. So Landmark, I think, is a subsidiary of bpost, and then Spring is a subsidiary of PostNL. And they are able to provide you with sort of like a better mix of different carriers in the background. You buy the shipping from them, so it's an easy access point to a range of different carriers. Of course, you could consolidate them yourselves and local inject into a destination market as well. You would then, for instance, send an entire pallet of shipments to a country you would like to ship to. You would find somebody in that local market to then unpack all of these shipments and direct inject into one of the local networks, one of the domestic networks. That's also an opportunity you could do very well to get started. Especially when you've passed the phase of your own contract, multiple destinations, I think it's a good logical next step to then also try consolidating shipments and direct inject. Next to that, I think we also have fulfillment, of course, in the destination country. So when you have exceeded a certain volume, I think it would pay out to try to find a fulfillment company in the destination market. They would hold your inventory, of course, do also some picking and packing. They do have often local expertise, so they would know like which shipping options would be required for your local market. They would be able to give you quite some advice. But yeah, the downside of this approach, I think, is also that you do not have as much control over which carriers are used. They often try to bring over or bring under all of the volume on their preferred carriers because they get best rates there. That might not also be the best solution for your end customer. So it really limits your options, although it definitely also has some advantages as well. Direct injection, I think, sort of like is the last step, I think, for the slightly larger enterprises, which are able to then arrange a direct line haul from one of their warehouses or multiple of their warehouses, and then just leverage from local contracts where they label all of the local the shipments themselves for the destination country. And then a line haul is arranged via plane or truck directly into the destination market. To take in consideration anybody that doesn't have any experience with line haul, that can be expensive, of course. Hiring a truck, I don't know, from Spain to the Netherlands is like 2,500 for just one single drive. So if you want to do that on a daily basis, you would need quite large volumes to be able to compensate with the lower shipping rate that you get from the local labels that you buy. So it's something you can take into consideration. Simple math that at some point just pays out when you exceed a certain volume. What I would want to point out is that myparcel.com actually covers almost any phase that I've just discussed. The phase where you buy your shipping rates from a reseller, something that we do not offer. Our solution is not very suited for the smallest online stores. We typically focus on the online stores that have more complicated setups. So that's all of the possible approaches that I've just discussed. So that ranges from consolidation, direct injection into the local markets, using your own contracts. We also have the availability to access the specialized cross-border specialists. So we have a lot of contracts in our contract library, as we call it. So that way you would still be able, via one connection, to still leverage from local contracts, which are also present in our system. And that's what we focus on, to be really a platform. So not offer the shipping ourselves. You wouldn't buy shipping from us. You would either arrange it yourself, or you would be able to find it via our software with our contract library. So I think that's sort of like the point that I was trying to make, is that you're going through different phases as a company. Make sure you're prepared for every transition of the phase that you're going in, and make sure that your supplier are also able to cope with your different needs during every phase. And I think that's the most important message that I would like to get across today.
Yep.
I think that's it for now, for my part, Ernst.
Great. Thanks, Lars. That was very elaborate on what type of phasing there is already in this domain. But maybe also for the crowd to understand your business model a little bit better, right?
Sure.
So you're not processing, obviously, the parcels yourself, so that you're the facilitator in a way. But, you know, in number of transactions, or where should we position you guys on an annual basis? You don't have to tell all the secrets, but, you know, few points might be nice for us.
Yeah, sure. Now, we're a relatively new player in the market, so we consider ourselves to be within the space of enterprise shipping, which are the likes of Metapack, which are our main competitor. Consigner, those kind of businesses, that's what we have to compete with. We are not as big as they are. However, we do win the same business. So we're quickly growing, which is nice. In terms of amount of shipments that we process each year, we'll go into the direction of 40 to 50 million. But that's also because we focus on customers that ship over 1 million parcels a year. That's sort of like where our sweet spot is. Mm-hmm. Often we are used alongside Consigner or Metapack as a backup solution, or as a more flexible solution to integrate new carriers, which we do a lot faster than they currently can, which is understandable because they have a lot of more legacy, more customers to support, which is understandable. However, that's where we sort of like fit in.
Okay. Is there anybody in the room already using MyParcel? Anybody using Metapack? Yeah? Anybody using Metapack at the moment for your label solutions? No? Oh, there you go. You would like to comment on this one? Is this... Just wait for the mic.
Okay.
Just wait for the mic, you know, and you don't have to tell the dirty secrets, but, you know, just give us a little bit of a view as to why you sort of choosing, you know, an integrator like Metapack or MyParcel.
So we only went live with it on Monday. So
all right.
Still getting used to it, and it was done through 3PL that we're using.
Okay. So you have already 3 days of data, all right? Yeah.
If you could ship orders out, yeah, but yeah, we've not seen anything.
Yeah, but what happened before? Why did you feel that you needed a third-party solution for your outbound shipping?
It was chosen by the 3PL that we were using.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay.
Were they already integrated with Metapack, the 3PL? Was that a new integration for them as well?
It was a brand new integration. Okay. So that was Manhattan and Metapack.
And what time did you need to start when you had the idea to work with Metapack up to the integration? Like, what is the time span that you took?
So it was about 3 months.
3 months.
And then we also used Metapack, or looked at using them previously for DSV, sort of third-party retailers that we were using as well.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for that. Is there anybody questions for Lars? Otherwise, we move to some of the slides. You have a question? Can you move to the mic here? And can you identify yourself, which company you represent?
Hello, hi. I liked your question. So maybe you can explain the most typical reasons why companies are using Metapack or MyParcel.
Sure.
To better understand. So.
Yeah, it's a little bit sort of, you know, when you go to a doctor, right? So you have a certain illness and you need a cure, right? Sort of, when do you know that you're really ill to get the cure? So
sure. Well, very good question, of course. Like, once you've integrated a carrier yourself, that's how most people start. They have a development team and they just need one or two carriers to integrate. They've done it themselves. It's just a very sometimes boring, but also can be difficult process, because you're you need to integrate with different APIs, which have different standards as well. So a lot of carriers, like their technology can be very different. Sometimes it can be very easy to integrate, but when you work with other carriers in certain markets, they can be very complicated. So it's quite demanding on your development team. It's boring work as well. So I think if you give your development team the time to like integrate 5 or 6, I think they will not be happy. So
maybe I can ask a clarifying question. When I already work with, let's say, 2 suppliers, right?
Yeah.
How do you add on that one? You know, can I still keep my supplier, or will you sort of, you know, I get a contract, so do I need to cancel my contract and you take that over? How would that work?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, we have a lot of customers, actually almost all of our customers already work with one of the competitors. So that's what we always start with. We work with Consign or Metapack, or because they own like 90% of the market already, at least the business that we are focused on. And they are then requesting those companies to then integrate new services, and that just takes too long. So you also have your own KPIs within your business, right? You need to roll out certain amount of countries within a certain amount of time because you just need new business to come in. If you're restricted by your current supplier, then you're looking for alternatives, and that's where we come in. They find us, we explain all of our SLAs that we can integrate a new carrier that's not in a library within 4 to 6 weeks, which is quite special. Then we have a talking point to get from, and then they use us alongside their current solution, so as a parallel solution for new carriers, but eventually they're also transferring all of their existing volume as well to our solution. So okay, that's thanks. Our foot in the door, and then we hope to get more.
Okay, so if I understand well, it's basically you have all the API integrations with all these carriers.
Yes.
And if I'm a retailer and I would like to expand to 4 countries very quickly, and maybe in each country to have like 3 solutions, then it would mean like I would have to do the 12 API integrations myself.
Yes.
And I don't want to put that burden on my own IT department, so I go to a company like yours who
exactly
has it. Okay.
Yeah. But also, like, if you've already went past that process, like if you started integrating a few carriers, when Brexit kicked in, it required adjustments on all carriers. So if you were to do that yourself, you had to like make adjustments to 12 different carriers in your own backend systems just to be able to be compliant with whatever is needed. And these kind of changes are done on a regular basis. And that's also the trouble that we take out of your hands to make sure that we are compliant in the backend.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for asking that question. Any other questions in this domain? No? Okay, can we take some of the Slido questions? You know the drill if you have been in one of these workshops before. Can you go to slido.com and then type in the code? And then we run a couple of questions on this one. And this also equally applies for the people that are on the live stream. So we may hear answers that we cannot sort of immediately track back into this audience. So it would be nice if you go through the first question and ask, how did changes in the playing field affect your business? And one of the answers could be dramatically. So it really changed it, right? Or not at all. I'm not sure how many answers we
got. We got 100, but it's very reliable.
Yeah. Now we have 4 answers. So we still wait a little bit. Just guys, take your phone out and then, you know, participate in this one. You know, the more we participate, the more rich the data gets, the more intelligence you can bring home. So you go back to your company and says, "Oh, I got a lot of new ideas, and this is what the world has to say." Okay. So we come back with 7 questions, and there's one person also mentioning dramatically. So there must be a business as well. Is there anybody in the room who answered dramatically, which is related to the changes in the playing field, recent Brexit? Did you answer that or not? Yeah, but did it change? Maybe you would like to comment on your answer. Maybe you can move the mic. Yeah, just identify the company as well. Yeah.
Hi, I'm from Grover.
Yeah, great.
Just to clarify, the question is the playing field is the...
Yeah, it's like Brexit, COVID, right? The recent changes that we really saw.
And I misunderstood the question.
Okay. Yeah, did it have an impact on your business?
No, we don't ship to the UK.
Okay. Yeah. And COVID? Did COVID?
COVID, yes. COVID did change it dramatically in the good way.
In a good way. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's dramatically can be also in a positive way. But you didn't have to close shop, otherwise you wouldn't be here, right? There you go. Okay. So let's move to the next question. The next question is, when are you currently preparing rollouts to new countries? So if you're going for expansion, right, when would that be? Right? Is that, if you want to do the expansion, and everybody, you know, you're a little bit more trigger happy, which is a good sign, right? You're an e-com, so you need to move snappy, right? You need to move quick. So, and people look for changes 2022. People are bullish about sort of what will be coming up next. So Lars, would you like to comment? How do you compare this to your constituency of current clients and prospects?
Yeah, and I think, like I said, the time is now in the beginning of the presentation. And it also, because customers just tell me the time is now and they have more interest in like kind of our kind of solution, so multi-carrier solution. So that's how I notice on a day-to-day basis, is that there's more interest in our product, which is great. I think when you look at the figures, you see that the time is now as well. So it's both just the figures, but also the feedback that I get from my current customers.
Cool. And is there something, you know, you see more and more dropship models emerging, right? Sort of, you know, we learn from Alibaba, AliExpress, et cetera, type of models, and we apply those in Europe more and more. Do you see that as a trend in this domain as well?
Me, not per se. Might also have to do with the type of customers that we are currently working for, is that dropshipping is not that big of a deal. And also because then the dropshipping is then probably arranged by the one that does the dropshipment. Mm-hmm. And they probably are not, they do not need a solution like ours. So I think that's why I do not get into contact with those.
Okay. Too much. So rather than asking questions, we also get other questions as well. Coming back to you, in a rapid fire. How is this increase on delayed parcels for domestic or international network? I think you showed the graph, right? Typically,
sure.
Where you
said
sort of, hey, this is an example client.
Yeah.
Did we see that across the board?
This example is actually for domestic shipping, but we do see this across the board. So the graphs that I just shown was actually for a Dutch domestic market.
A question from Paula. When you help integrate a new carrier, will we get the market rates or significantly discounted rates? So I think Paula is a very good negotiator. She knows what to ask for immediately. So she goes straight to the point, Lars. There you go.
Yeah, no, great. We will not offer rates at all. So we will just help with the technical part of it. So you would need to arrange your own rates with the carrier. However, as I shown in that last slide where you saw the layering of our system, we also have rates of partners within our library, which we call the contract library. And that gives the ability to, you see that with Spring, which is located in 13 different European countries. All of their rates are in the system. So if you like to start in a new country, they already have a good offering there. You would buy the shipping directly from them. So there wouldn't be a legal agreement between us for shipping itself. There would be a sort of like a three-way, so a technical agreement with us and then a shipping agreement with the one arranging the shipping. So that
But you could provide some reference pricing in a way, right? Sort of,
it's all in the system, so we know the prices within those markets.
Yeah.
I could help you find them and we can help them activate them within our system. So, yeah.
But it's not the case that the sort of it sounds a little bit suspicious, right? So Spring puts their rates in and you use that as a reference. There's no immediate lower sort of benefit for you to promote Spring in this.
No, we make money on the label fee.
Yeah.
So the more successful our businesses are, customers are, the more money we make. So for us, volume is sort of like everything. We try to make our customers as big as possible.
Okay. So. Good to just to put that as a disclaimer.
Yeah, sure.
From Mr. or Mrs. Anonymous, what percentage of business do you see that use of their own integrations before switching to MyParcel? That's more like a technical question. So if you know, what do you need effectively to move it quickly?
Which percentage do you see use their own? To be honest, we have 10% of our customers that actually did it themselves previously, but I think that mainly has to do with the sweet spot we have in terms of new customers, which start over like 500,000 shipments a year, sort of like where it starts with. And they almost all already came to the conclusion that working with an integrator saves them a lot of time. And they're working with one of our competitors mostly, and then we're moving in as a parallel option later.
Cool. Okay. Good. Good. So we had the questions now from that are dripping in. They don't hesitate to pull a new question forward. So question number three: Have you ever been slowed down by your shipping technology? You have some glitches in there. There would be all kinds of shit happening when you go for the integration. Yeah, within your first 3 days, you probably have all kinds of shit happening. But sorry for my French there. What is the most favorite answer? And that can obviously sort of display in many categories, right? Sort of, maybe you can give one or two examples, Lars, from your experience where things, are slowing down.
Yeah, it largely depends on the technology of the provider. So although it's great that some of them have a lot of carriers integrated into their library, it's still not a guarantee that you will be able to use them quite fast. And that depends on their backend systems, how they're all connected. So I would advise anybody that works with an integrator to really have a very strict SLA when it comes to adding new services if you need them, arranging new carriers if you need them, but also existing carriers within their library. I would definitely advise you to have an SLA that really defines how quickly you're able to access them.
But you see that from experience, right? It doesn't sound really like a secret tip that we said, okay, we learned something, but apparently many people forget to really put that into...
It's the main reason why we started myparcel.com. What we did in the beginning is, when we first started, we had almost no carriers in our library. And we had to compete with a company like Metapack that had 350 carriers in their library. So we spoke to Metapack and we asked them, can we leverage from your API and maybe use all of these 350 carriers? Which sounded great in the brochure, but then we really started developing on it, and it was so sluggish and it took us so long that we then came to the conclusion this is a gap in the market where we need to like really jump in and really help out others that are facing that same issue. And that's where we now have our solution for. So,
okay. Yeah. That's nice to have one of those examples. So let's move to question number four. Can we run the next question, please? This is this depends on very much on where you are. What phase do you consider your e-commerce business to be in? Right? You're already mature. You're in the early stages, expansion, and sort of the second stage, the acceleration phase, and then the little bit in between type of thing. So anybody like to answer on this or to where in which area you would see MyParcels playing best? You have to be a mature business, or which is where are your most successful integrations with?
It depends, because you cannot really strictly define. A startup can be very ambitious. They can have funding to really roll out immediately in multiple countries and really do it properly. However, typically we do not work for a whole lot of startups really self-funded, because there's just the investment cost in creating the integration. And there's also almost no need to really start with multi-carrier approach, because they often just trial out their product in the startup phase with just one carrier. Yep. But like all of the more mature, like everything but startup, I guess. Yeah.
Okay. Good to understand. Maybe to run the next question and then move to question number five. When is your best time to start consider cross-border shipping? That's also a little bit trick question in a way. Sort of, it depends on very much what type of business model you're operating with. But maybe you can give your best guess on this one, right? After Corona, that's a tricky answer, right? Or after COVID, Corona can also be a beer, right? I'm trying to avoid this, too busy already. So everybody feels that there's a good opportunity, right? And it's also acting now. I guess, Lars, would you like to, anybody like to comment on this? On the answer? For the internationalization of your business? Okay, not really. So we'll move to the now, I guess. Lars, is that how you feel?
With your I feel, but it's also partially our own benefit. Of course, we live off of this, so I might not be the most neutral person to ask. However, if you look at the market, it's just a very good time to now start considering going abroad, especially because there's huge opportunity. The pie is getting bigger and bigger, and that gives opportunities to everybody. We can all benefit from that as well within e-commerce.
Yeah, so what you're saying is sort of the momentum, right? What people say. So there's momentum now to pick up, you know, even post-COVID. Things are probably moving a little bit back to normal, but not entirely. So, you know, put your money where...
One thing that I could maybe add to that, look, I do know or feel that there's, from a consumer perspective, a lot of interest in products from abroad, right? That you cannot get in your home market. I think everybody, the e-commerce market in for instance, the Dutch market is quite mature. There's a lot of products there, but like also requesting, I don't know, typical British products for the Dutch as well is something that everybody's very interested in. And I think that also opens a great opportunity for people that have products that are not available yet in new markets to really gain some market share there being diverse.
No, it's a great phenomenon to highlight again. You know, it's by digitization by default, right? So you're opening up a bigger market anyway. So if you can't find clever models to accommodate that, then it's that definitely the now. And there's no large impediments at the moment anymore in the market. Brexit, we know more or less how it will play out. We seem to come into a post-COVID area. Retail is clawing back. You know, we know what is going to happen in the next 3 to 6 months. No crystal ball here, but I think we are we're moving progressively forward.
Maybe one thing that I could add to that. There, of course, people are moving back to the stores, right? So they are able to move back to the stores now, which is great for anybody that really appreciates that experience. But it also requires retailers to offer a better user experience that can actually compete with that store experience more. So being just offering a better shipping experience, but overall user experience for any of your customers is very important. To also maintain all of the gained new business that you've won during COVID to make sure that it doesn't leave again.
That is
important.
No, that's an important tip, I think, for everyone to consider. Are there any questions from the audience at this point in time? We're moving to the end of the session. There's potentially a couple of more questions left, but I think we got the main we covered the main ones. Any burning question for Lars at the moment on myparcel.com, the shipping platform for international? No. That's good. You have been very clear, Lars. So that
apparently,
is
apparently.
Yeah, and at least from my perspective, I must say I've learned a few things definitely on terms of the dynamics in the market. I didn't realize that some of those market developments were this bullish, right? That we are sort of doubling market and in size and in revenue as well. Yeah. And I thought there were some really sort of good materials in there with your knowledge in the market, because you're so close on top of what is happening with your with your clients. The other part I learned is also in which you can play, that there is established markets players like Metapark and others doing a really good job, and that there is still space for a runner-up for a challenger in this market, although you would feel it becomes quite mature, and that you have been able to crack the nut with a sort of a pragmatic approach. Yep. I'm still confused why PostNL ever allowed you to use myparcel.com, you know, selling myparcel.nl to PostNL, and then you can use myparcel.com, but that's something probably later on for the drinks in the bar for you to explain to the audience. So any final comments from you, Lars, before we split and move to the next level?
No, I just want to thank everybody for coming. Thank you for your time. I hope you have a safe travel at home, to your home. And if you need any addresses in Amsterdam, I will be happy to share some restaurant tips or whatever. So feel free to contact me after or at a later stage. Yeah.
it's good to hear the hospitality is always there with the Dutchies in there. So hope to see you back some at some of the activities that we still have planning for you. Right after this, please join as well in the plenary hall for the award session, and there will be a final masterclass as well with a few interesting speakers, amongst others BOL.com, which is having an incredible ride on how they have, let's say, conquered the market in only a few years' time, and a few others that that's definitely worth your stay. And otherwise, the drinks are also, you know, worth to stay. So thank you so much for joining. Thank you a lot, Lars, for leading us through your journey. And have a great stay, or have a safe trip home. Thank you all.
Thanks. Thank you.